I want to tap the microphone. Hey, how's everybody doing? Hey, is that the Hokey Bird in here? What's up, Hokey Bird? Show some Hokey Bird love. Awesome. All right, thanks for coming out to class tonight, everybody. Everybody ready for Thanksgiving break? Yeah! All right! About that time. We do have one class to get through today and a few classes after break. Gosh, it's getting close to the end of the semester already, isn't it? And as promised in the emails and communications via the social networks, we do have some special guests here tonight from Invisible Children. And before we introduce our main guest, I want to thank everybody who's shown support for Invisible Children in the past, who has already seen some of the movies. Let me get a shout out, round of applause. How many people have already seen one or more of the Invisible Children movies? Okay. The hell's the Hokey Bird going? What the hell? We're gonna cook your ass up, Hokey Bird, for Thanksgiving. Yeah. Come on out here, Hokey Bird. All right. Oh, it's got the Coney 2012 t-shirt on. That's awesome. Can somebody send me a picture of this, please? Pretty please. Thanks. Competition. First five pictures win. 4, 3, 2, 1. Game on. Isn't social networking and modern technology so much fun? Thanks, Hokey Bird. You're too awesome for coming out. So everybody in the room is actually at least a little bit, if not a lot bit, familiar with this. So, without any further ado, let me do an intro little media film for you here, and then we'll get to our special guest. And I fully expect to raise the roof. We're gonna do some roof raising in here, yes? Okay, all right. Okay. Then go ahead and roll them, and then we'll get to our friend. Let's go this way. You're gonna stay there?
On October 14th, 2011, President Barack Obama deployed around 100 military advisors to Central Africa to help stop the world's worst warlord, Joseph Kony. This decision was a direct result of an 8-year journey by the hundreds of thousands of young people that became a movement for justice. Invisible Children was founded on the belief that international justice is the future of humanity. We discovered an unseen war in Central Africa where children were being abducted and turned into child soldiers by a rebel leader named Joseph Kony. Kony is the first individual indicted by the International Criminal Court for committing the worst crimes against humanity. We called on the youth of the world to help their fellow youth in Central Africa. We have sent over 1,000 well-trained young people around the United States on 3-month road trips, hosting screenings of our documentary films and leading discussions with their peers at high schools and colleges. Since 2005, we have hosted over 10,000 screenings to a direct audience of over 3.5 million people. For the majority of the audience, this is their first exposure to an issue of international criminal justice.
I was just in high school one day and I saw it, changed my life, and I wanted to take action. It's a responsibility of ours to demand change in the world for the injustice that's going on.
I think this gathering of young people working for all young people in a remote place is for me a dream. It's a dream. It's the idea of a global community, protecting each other.
Through their involvement with Invisible Children, hundreds of thousands of students encounter life-changing experiences and become engaged as global citizens. To mobilize this group, we hosted an international awareness event in over 100 cities worldwide called The Rescue. Over 80,000 young supporters slept outside for up to 6 days to rally support for the arrest of Joseph Kony. The momentum from the event carried on to Washington, D.C., and with the help of our partners, we met face-to-face with leaders in the U.S. Congress, encouraging them to sign on to the LRA Disarmament and Northern Uganda Recovery Act, legislation mandating President Obama to assist the international effort to remove Joseph Kony from the battlefield. Over 2,000 supporters rallied on Capitol Hill, embarking on over 500 meetings with members of Congress. It was the largest African issue lobby day in the history of the United States. After years of great effort and tenacity, the Invisible Children community celebrated the United States Senate's unanimous passage of the bipartisan LRA disarmament bill, which has become the most widely co-sponsored Africa-focused legislation in U.S. history. And as a direct result, just over 1 year later, on October 14th, 2011, President Obama committed 100 troops to help end the conflict. This is the most significant and comprehensive approach ever taken to stop the LRA violence. And it is a huge victory for the hundreds of thousands of young people who have advocated for the victims of the LRA. Despite all this progress, Kony is still a fugitive of justice and continues to wreak havoc on innocent populations throughout Central Africa. He has not stopped. And neither will we. Invisible Children will continue calling on the citizens of the world to unite for the victims of the LRA and for Joseph Kony to be brought to justice.
You good? Okay. You guys good? Yes? Okay, well, again, thanks everybody for all the support you've shown thus far. And now, all the way from the headquarters in San Diego, California, on a cross-country tour going towards Washington, D.C. to actually rally your elected officials and, dare I say, your president of the United States, as well as a dozen African leaders that are coming over for this special event on this Saturday. Ladies and gentlemen, one of the co-founder of Invisible Children, which he helped found when he was your age, Jason Russell, everybody, give it up, give it up, give it up, that's what I'm talking about, give it up.
Thank you. Yeah. Okay. I'm here. I'm here. Can you hear me? Here's to the crazy ones. The misfits, the rebels, the round pegs and the square holes. The ones who see things differently. They're not fond of rules and they pay no attention to the status quo. You can disagree with them. You can quote them. You can glorify or vilify them. But the one thing you can't do is ignore them, because they change things. They push the human race forward. And while some see them as crazy, we see genius. Because the people who think that they are crazy enough to change the world are the ones who do. This, my whole life, I have dreamt of being called crazy. And 2012, this year, man, that dream came true. That dream came very true. And I'm here tonight to let you know my clothes are staying on. So don't worry, they will stay on for the rest of my life, as much as I can. Yeah, yeah, exactly. So I have a question. How many of you have already signed up? Because the rumor has it that there's 250 individuals from Virginia Tech who have signed up to come to Move DC this Saturday. Will you stand up if you've already signed up to come? Stand up, be strong, be tall, give them a round of applause. Stand up. You guys have an amazing adventure ahead of you. I just got out of a car from Washington, D.C. It was the most beautiful 4 hour and 20 minute drive. The music was had a dream. We know about that dream today. And what was happening during the Civil Rights Movement in Birmingham, Alabama, is that the individuals who were part of the Civil Rights Movement were getting tired. They were waning. They had to go back to their jobs. Some of them were losing their jobs. And so Dr. Martin Luther King and his friends had an idea. And the idea was that they would send children first. Children would lead the way, would lead the march. It was the young people that would do it. High school, junior high, elementary students. And so in 1963, the children led the march. Young African American boys and girls left school, ditched school, and went to the 16th Street Baptist Church, where they met, sang some hymnals, and started marching. Marching the freedom marches that they did. And the police in Birmingham, Alabama, were outlawing it. So they got buses and they shipped the children, as many as they could, onto the bus and then back to the jails until all of the jails were full with children. And the next day, more children came and marched, meeting at the 16th Street Baptist Church. And they continued to march. This time, the police got hoses out and started spraying them down with fire hoses, little children, getting canine dogs to scare them away and attack them. And so that night, all the parents and all the congregation met as over 2,000 children were kept captive in jail, held there. And Dr. Martin Luther King, he took the stage and he said, "Never before in this nation have so many young people been imprisoned for the cause of human freedom and dignity." Now he said, "Don't worry about your children. They're going to be all right because they are doing a cause not only for themselves, but for this great nation and all mankind. For they are carving a whole tunnel into the great mountain of despair. And they will bring to this nation a newness and a genuine quality and an idealism that it so desperately needs." He said, "What we are challenged to do now is to keep this movement moving, keep this movement rolling, despite the difficulties, and there will be difficulties left to come. Keep climbing. If you can't fly, run. If you can't run, walk. If you can't walk, crawl. But by all means, keep moving." After this year, the year of Kony 2012, the year we had the most viral video in the history of the world, the year of a mental, naked breakdown, the year in which thousands and hundreds of thousands and millions of people woke up to this idea of international justice, we all looked to Dr. Martin Luther King and we said, "We have to keep this movement moving. We have to keep this movement rolling because it's right and because it's just." Now, the truth is, surrounding Dr. Martin Luther King or any great heroes of human rights, of justice, the individuals we know so well, the Mother Teresa's, the Mahatma Gandhi's, Dr. Martin Luther King, Nelson Mandela, the people that you don't meet, the people that you don't know, are the ones who are surrounding them. And we at Invisible Children call them anonymous extraordinaries. And that's what many of us in this room are called to be. Some of us are called and destined to do great things. And maybe we write that book, or make that film, or become the professor in the plaid jacket. Maybe that's who we're called to be. But a lot of us are called to be anonymous extraordinaries, to be there at the speech of I Have a Dream, to attend something like Move DC, which is going to be the first time in American history where this many people are gathered for a cause that is about Africa. It is historical, and it is epic, and nothing like it of its kind has ever been. Thousands of people are flying in from around the world to convene a meeting, and 9 out of the 10 world leaders that we have asked to be there will be there. I believe Like Dr. Martin Luther King said many times, that the moral arc of the universe is long, but it bends towards justice. The moral arc of the universe is long, but it bends toward justice. And I believe that the 250 of you who stood up, and those of you that are online watching, if you're going, and you stood up in your dorm room, that must have felt awkward, but I'm telling you, we see you. And you're the ones who first hear the call of history. And I believe that history does take attendance. No one in this room yet has found a way to escape death. And so someday soon, we will die. And we will just leave a fingerprint, a footprint here on earth. But I believe that in the afterlife, everyone that we have known who have come before us, and everyone we know who come after us, our grandchildren and their grandchildren and great-grandchildren. I believe that in the afterlife that we will have a tribunal, a meeting, where we surround in one circle, and our great-grandchildren will ask us, where were you during the Rwandan genocide when 1 million people died in 100 days? And the world did nothing. Where were you when Joseph Kony and his commanders were abducting children by the tens of thousands and forcing them to fight as child soldiers? Where were you? And those of you that have signed up for Move DC already, you get to say, I was there. I showed up. I was on the side of justice. And that, ladies and gentlemen, will make history. Will make history. You can say, I was an anonymous extraordinary doing what I was called to do, and that was to show up and to be there. And I know that Virginia Tech is a legacy school across this great nation. It is one that stands out among the most, the best. And I'm here today to say that you are just a few people away from being the most represented school, university, in the entire world at Move DC with the numbers you already have. And for those of you who are debating, should I go home to Thanksgiving? It's the weekend, we're already out of school, or should I give up that Saturday and be a part of history? I know you guys heard we're surrounding the entire White House. And I don't know if you heard after that, after we meet with the 10 leaders, we're gonna have a 3-hour dance party. That's gonna be crazy. We're planning, don't worry, lasers, smoke, everything's there. 4 DJs, 3 dance crews. Who cares, you guys? You don't want to miss it, okay? It's gonna be a blast. It's always been our dream at Invisible Children. When I say ours, I mean mainly Bobby, Laren, and myself, who started Invisible Children, to have us be the narrators or the person who gets you into the story, but to have the true story and the true stars be the individuals who were the victims and the survivors of this war. That if people could truly celebrate and remember their stories and fight for their human dignity. And a couple years ago, we got to invite Ugandans over to speak on behalf of themselves. And tonight, we have the privilege of hearing from one of the sweetest, most graceful, most incredible individual named Stella. So please give her a warm welcome to the stage.
Hi, everyone. I would say this is my home. A lot of you may know why I say this. In 1 year, this is my third time in VT. And that is why I call it my home. Yeah. I love VT community because you guys know how to love. Right from the entrance today, I can't tell the number of people who have given me hugs and smiles and have told me, I remember you, I remember you. and that mends my heart. And that is what makes me feel so comfortable at VT. And I would like to say, for those who have never met me, my name is Stella, and I come from northern Uganda. And back in Uganda, I have worked, and I still work with Invisible Children as a mentor, and I've done this for 6 years, helping kids who have gone through a lot of trauma because of the war to overcome their trauma and be normal, good human beings who can participate in the development of the world, wherever they will be in the future. And I love doing that, and it gives me joy to see these kids change from the worst situation to the best situation. And I haven't been doing that alone. It has been because people like you did a lot for the many years that we have existed as an organization. So we've been doing this together in partnership with you. And that is why we are here tonight, so that we can continue with already the existing partnership that we've been having through your contribution in different ways. And changing lives or ending the war does not necessarily mean you should give money. There are so many ways of contributing, of joining us to bring this war to an end and to let these kids have smiley faces like you're seeing on me right now. I went through a lot, but if you look at my smile, you may not tell. It's because somebody did something good to make Northern Uganda safe and to bring back the smile that you see on my face today. And because of that, I am inviting you guys personally to join us on November 16th and 17th at DC, so that we can put our time together and our voices and let the world lead us. Turn the promises they've made using words into action, to agree together on what they can do to bring this war to an end. And it's so joyful to be a part of great things that can change the world, that can make other people happy. You may not yet know if you haven't done it, but after becoming a part of it, you would not live like wanting to walk away from helping to make other people happy. You can ask me after this at a personal level, and I'll share with you a lot how joyful it is to change people's lives. Thank you so much for listening to me, and I would love to see all of you come 16th and 17th at DC. Thank you so much.
So, how do you get there? I know we already have a bus going, but we have more tricks up our sleeves in ways to get you there easily, cheaply, to make it smooth and happen. And one of the individuals who is an anonymous extraordinary, who works tirelessly, she doesn't have to do it, it's not her job, she's not getting extra points, she's not making any money doing it, she's doing it because she believes in it, and she's the president of the VT Invisible Children Club. Kelsey, please come to the stage with your friends that have put all of this together. Please welcome to the stage. Come on out.
Hi guys, I'm Kelsey. I'm the president of Invisible Children at Virginia Tech, and we're so excited that there's so many of you here. This is awesome. I just wanna introduce the rest of the people who have been super helpful. This is Amy, Aaron, Becca, and Shannon. And then anyone else who you see in these shirts, they were also really helpful, huge team players throughout this whole thing, so thanks, guys. So what we're here to help you out with tonight is helping you get to DC. So we set up a carpool system. So if you go into the back, right in the center of the lobby back there, our computer set up for you guys with a Google spreadsheet. So if you have a car and you can go to DC and you can take people with you in your car, go to the Google spreadsheet, put in your information, put in the number of people that you can take, all the information it has on there, and then if you need a ride, go to the same Google spreadsheet, same computer, and sign up. Just put your name and your email. And then it's up to you guys, once you have placed yourselves in cars, to figure out when you want to go, when you want to meet, how you're going to, you know, split up gas money, that kind of thing. But that's the resource that we're offering for you. We hope that it's going to be helpful. If you have any questions, just let us know. And also, these guys will be in the back afterwards to help you out with signups if you want to sign up for Move DC tonight.
Now, if they sign up, do they get a shirt and a bracelet?
I believe you do.
So you get a shirt and a bracelet if you sign up tonight. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Anything else?
That's all. Also, if you're interested in actually joining our chapter at Virginia Tech, just come talk to any of us in a t-shirt. We'll get you on the listserv. We do a lot of fundraising and awareness events on campus, and we'll start up strong again once we get back from fall break. Thanks,
Amazing.
Guys.
Thank you, guys. So we at Invisible Children believe that education leads to empowerment, leads to activism, leads to life change, leads to world change. And there's no one that I know on earth that personifies that more than your teacher. You are very fortunate and blessed to be in a class like this. I believe he's the future of education. I believe he is the most dynamic, fun, interesting, crazy person that I know. And I wish I could stay and take his class every session, but I can't. But we'll stay in touch for sure. And we are just so grateful. From myself and Invisible Children, Stella, we all thank you for opening up your school and this classroom to us, because it really is changing the world. So thank you very much. Peace, you guys.
It'll live. That thing's been through worse. It's all good. Okay, before people start asking me, and I've already gotten to several emails, I think what we'll do is probably should give you some credit for going to that rally if you're really going to go. Is anybody interested in that? Some credit for class? I'm going to devise some sort of assignment that'll be like a photojournalism kind of thing for you. So either you can take some pictures of yourself there and write a paper for, I don't know, a bunch of points, or even more points, maybe do a blog. And do remember that there's still an open offer. If you get your picture taken beside a sitting head of state, that's like 100 or 200 points, isn't it? And there's going to be a whole bunch of important people there. So the odds are good. That would be hilarious, by the way, if that happens. So, yeah, I would plan on that for those of you that are in the D.C. area. We know it's challenging. We know it's tough because it's Thanksgiving break and everybody's getting ready to go home. But a lot of you live in Northern Virginia. So if you want to take advantage of that opportunity as a double bonus kind of outside event that you can do a paper assignment blog on for points, we will make that happen. Is that cool with everybody? Yes? Okay. All right, cool. Any questions about anything before we get going? Oh, and if you were just here to talk with the Visible Children folks, or if you're motivated and want to sign up now, you can go maybe talk to Jason. Maybe him and Stella will stay in the back of the auditorium back there. That'd be awesome. You can go chat with them right now or during class. You know this classroom's pretty open, pretty fluid. Maybe if it gets too loud, we can just shut the doors. But if you are fired up and want to go talk to them right now, I heartily encourage it. They're pretty special people. I do like to stress that they started this organization, him and his two buddies, when they were in college your age. This is an organization that has now turned into a kind of global movement to stop this one dude. And it shows you the power that one person can make, even, you know, you. He was a dude in college just like everybody in this room right now and decided to do this and has made a big difference in the world. Yes, sir.
Do reflections count with the
word being a
picture?
I'm sorry, do the... Yeah. No, it can't be a reflection. They actually have to recognize you, and you have to be standing beside them when you get your picture with the head of state. Although, I might give bonus points for photobombing. If you can get close enough to photobomb a sitting president, that might be hilarious. And hopefully the CIA is not listening to this conversation and heard the word president and bomb in one sentence, and now they're going to be authorities waiting for me after class. All right, yes, sir. Hey, I thought you were going to sing. What happened?
I don't know.
I thought you were supposed to come on stage and sing.
I can do that, no problem.
Okay, well, let's wait till, because we're going to do your book drive too, right?
Yeah.
Let's do it after break. And you're going to sing for books. This guy's going to sing for books, right? Yeah, stand up and sing right now. Just stand up and sing like 30 seconds. Go. Let's see you do it. Oh. I don't know that we have the music. I think that's what we're waiting on. But you had a question. I didn't mean to put you on the spot. If you'll be in Washington, D.C. spiritually, can you get credit for that? You're all confusing me. You're trying to confuse me, and I like that. Right? I'm actually getting a lot happier and happier about this class, even though a lot of people in this class are getting less happy about it. So I'm actually getting into the mood, and the closer we get towards the end of the semester, the more kind of liberal I am getting with points. So you never know what could happen. I do heartily encourage attendance for our closing week. We have like three Wednesdays left after a Thanksgiving break, so heartily encourage attendance because you never know what can happen. That's all I'm going to say. You just never know what could happen. Yes, sir. Yeah, that is a good point. And if you send me an email, I'll send that out as well. We have a friend from Tanzania. Is that correct, sir? Our friend from Tanzania here started his own organization. He was inspired, much like the folks we had on stage earlier, to start his own organization as a book drive to get books to Tanzania and other places in Africa. So over break, if you have books at home that you know you're just going to chuck somewhere, bring them in and let's see if we can raise, like, how many books do you want to raise here in this class? He wants to raise 1,500. He wants donations of 1,500 books out of just this class. That's his goal. Can we do better than that? I'll say this. If we can get you 10,000 books, then everybody gets another 30 points of credit in this class. Period. All right? Straight up. That's the last word on that. 10,000 books, that ought to be easy. Just go start stealing them from the library. All right? That's all I'm saying. Yes. Yeah, any kind of books or?
Yeah, every kind of book. Textbooks, biographies.
The man's trying to stock the libraries of Africa. I love this guy. He's awesome.
As long as they've been written in English. Right?
What's that?
As long as they've been written in English.
Send me an email, we'll send it to everybody. Okay? Any other questions about anything? Good? Good? All right. Let's have a little bit of class then. Should we do that? Are you guys going to stick around for class? Oh, you guys are so nice. I love this class. I think I'm going to have to give some more points out. All right. You're so easy. You're so easy. It is the 10th Wednesday. We have just but three short Wednesdays left after today. And there's, of course, Thanksgiving break in between that. So next week, gobble, gobble, everybody, hit up the turkey. Have a good time with that. Hopefully everybody's up with quizzes. We're getting down to the brass tacks. Or, I'm sorry, was somebody asking a question or just yelling? Gobble, gobble. Yes.
Next week, we have to
keep
up with forum posts.
Do we do stuff over Thanksgiving break in terms of forum post? And do we have a weekly quiz? Hold on, I'm trying to talk here.
The weekly quiz ends on Sunday.
The weekly quiz ends on...
There's not one over break.
There's not a weekly quiz over break. Okay.
Forms you can still do, and Twitter, you will lose points if you don't.
Forms you can still do. Remember, all of this is optional, so you can still do your forms. And Katie just reminded me, if you're a Twitterer, that yes, actually it's mandatory that you keep Twittering. Although, again, you can just lose those points if you're having too good of a time, and that's cool, too. And what the hell is this? All right, anyway. Just joking. So someone said flash quizzes. So gobble gobble, do you want some flash quizzes over break? I want to make sure I'm understanding this correctly. You, a bunch of 18 to 22 year old college students, are asking me to give you a homework and a quiz over break. Do I have that right? And now everybody's yelling because they'll be worth triple turkey points. What the hell is triple turkey points, all right? I'll triple hokey points. Is there a difference between a hokey and a turkey? I'll eat either one. What? Yeah, okay, I'll do some flash quizzes over break. I have no problem with that. I will work, I'll throw them out there. If you guys wanna do them, it's cool with me. Is that okay? Yes, all right. I actually would like to do a live lecture over break that won't count as exam material, but if you would like to see a live lecture, maybe I'll finish this Russia lecture and do a flash quiz on it or something like that. But I will do a lecture live during break so that you can bring me to the Thanksgiving table and introduce me to your folks, and that would be hilarious. So your parents can see what they're paying for. I want to be that professor who's like, yeah, let's just keep the party going even over break, because apparently you guys want it as well. Tonight's film, we have had a change up because we lost the film we were supposed to show tonight. It happens. So for those of you that are coming to the film tonight, how many people are coming to the movie after this? The one I have chosen is called 5 Days of War. It's a really bad war film. Is that okay with everybody? I mean, it's bad just in terms of kind of it's funny. It's a new one, but it's mostly a propaganda piece from the Georgian government, which makes it hilarious. So we're going to swap that out. That's at 9:30 tonight. Do we have anything else? How are your points looking? Hopefully everybody is now almost finished acing this class. Finishing tonight, I hear, right? All right, good. How many people really are at the level that you're coasting in for your grade at this point? Round of applause. Coasting in. Okay. How many people gotta hunker down and do a little bit of work, but I'm going to make it okay? Okay. How many people, no matter how hard I work, I'm going to fail? Hey, there they are, the empty seats. Oh, no, we do have some people cheering. All right. Okay, what's going on in the news? We're 40 minutes late, but that's cool. Does anybody have any big news stories they want to chuck out? Big news stories. Let me give you a final exam question. Let me give you a final visual exam question right off the bat. Let's just do it. Does anybody know who's hanging out in Western Australia today? If you saw me Facebook or Twitter earlier, you know the answer to this. Who is in Western Australia today? Two people. Hillary Clinton and Leon Panetta. Your Secretary of State Hillary Clinton and your Secretary of Defense Leon Panetta are both hanging out in Western Australia today. That kind of shit doesn't happen that often, by the way. You don't typically have two major government players hanging out in one place. Now, I don't know a lot about how life works, but what do you think's going on if two of the most important people in the government are hanging out in one place on the same day? Something's going on, or it's vacation, and it's not vacation. Something is going on. So that'll be a test question. Both Hillary Clinton and Leon Panetta chilling out in Western Australia, where it was released through the Department of Defense just hours ago, that it's been declared that we, the United States, put a couple of different space station something in Western Australia. Isn't that cool? I think the United States is back into the space race, and Australia looks to be our new partner, the new kid on the block. The crocodile hunter wants to go to the moon, all right? So big things happening in Australia. I believe I've told you this already this semester. If not, let me tell you again and write it down and remember it. The United States, for the first time ever in history, is getting ready to put active military personnel in Australia. That is in the works. That's happening.
That base is going into northern Australia. Now we're looking at having some sort of communications, space relay, some space something stations going in western Australia. So this is kind of big news. It's going to get glossed over because maybe it's not that big a deal to you. But what I'm seeing is the United States is now turning to Australia as perhaps one of our most vital allies of the 21st century. That's what my eyes are seeing. Because Leon Panetta and Hillary Clinton ain't hanging out in Europe today. They ain't hanging out in Africa today, although lots is going on in Africa as well. They ain't hanging out in China today. They're hanging out in Australia. Australia looks to be our most strategic, vital partner in the Pacific for the rest of your lives. And it looks like the Aussies like it that way as well. So a little kind of covert, but I believe important news. And by the way, I got to say this to you. Maybe an easy exam question, just because I love giving out the easy ones that only you who have listened to this lecture will remember. The question will be something like, where did Boyer say you should really move to? And here's the answer. You should really move to Australia. I never thought I'd say that. Never thought I'd say it. Because Europe is way more awesome and Asia's way more happening. But right now, Australia's got it going on. For most of my adult life, actually even my younger life, I looked at Australia as kind of a backwater. And I mean that in the best way possible. It's a nice place. It's a great place to visit. It's huge in tourism. It's a chill place. Everybody's throwing a shrimp on the Barbie and shit. It's all casual. But right this second, their economy is on fire, and no one's paying attention to it because it's Australia. And the U.S. alliance with Australia is on fire. No one's paying attention to it because it's Australia. And big international companies from every single major field are moving to Australia. And no one's paying attention to it because it's Australia. Here, this may be twisted into an easy trivia question as well, but to kind of reinforce this idea, maybe I've told you this already, but while I was in Australia a couple weeks ago, I heard that Air France was moving a regional headquarters to Australia. Did I tell you this already? Did I tell you this on the online lecture? Air France, one of the biggest airlines of France, moving its regional headquarters to Australia. Here's the funny part. You ready for the punchline? Air France doesn't fly to Australia. There are no Air France planes in Australia. So why the hell would you put your regional headquarters in Australia? Location, location, location. They want to put their regional headquarters in Australia, one, because people who work for Air France would rather live in Australia than Asia, because it has the amenities they want, and maybe they speak the language they understand there. Two, there's the rule of law in Australia, stability in Australia, economic and political stability. And the main thing is three, which is it's a perfect little place to service your gigantic Asian market. Yeah, Air France probably has a regional hub or something going on in Beijing as well, but they got one in Australia. People want to work there. They want to move there, and they can service the 4 billion Asian customers from their regional hub in Australia. They're not the only one doing that. Lots of companies are going down there. So, sorry I got off on this Australian rant, mates. But this place is happening. It's vibrant. It's growing. I'm talking technologically and economically. It's a very interesting place to be right now. I don't say that about too many places on planet Earth. Yes? Yes. Yes, well said. Well said. He said it's becoming a centralized place because of economic growth, but also because of its location. It's strategically located to service all these Asian countries from India all the way up to China and Korea and Japan. And, of course, there are buddies, so that helps if you're an American citizen as well. Okay? Anything else going on in the news? Yes.
Israel?
What about Israel? That's a country, not a current event. Yes, several people emailed me earlier today to speak to the fact that the Israeli government slash the Israeli military, whoever, did a strategic bombing in the Gaza Strip earlier today and killed the head military commander of this group called Hamas. I would love to speak to you guys about that, but that will be the next hour and a half. And I promise you, we're going to get through Russia or close to it tonight. I'm going to do the rest of the Russia lecture online and give you flash quizzes on it if you want. And we're going to spend the rest of the semester talking about the Middle East, in which case I can properly introduce you to the evolution of Israel and the Gaza Strip and this political party called Hamas, so this makes more sense. Go ahead and jot this down now, though. For now, the main thing to draw from this story of an Israeli military strike inside of Gaza Strip is that it is likely to now rekindle a war in the Gaza Strip because, of course, people are going to try to strike back now. And the other thing to jot down is the Israeli military, possibly by the time you come back from Thanksgiving break, may reinvade and reoccupy the Gaza Strip. That's entirely possible. It's not out of the realm of the imagination here in the next 7 to 10 days. So we might have another Palestinian flare-up in our midst, and it may get very hot indeed by the time you get back from break. Okay? I'm sorry, I know I say this a lot, that I'm like, well, we can't really say much more about that story, otherwise we're here for 2 hours, because it's such a complex subject, as is most things in the Middle East. And so I want to make sure that you understand it fully. So we need to give a whole lecture to that. Okay? Anything else going on? You know, the hot topics in the world, in the news? Hey, to my Indian friends, what's going on? Diwali, yeah. Happy Diwali to all my Indian slash Hindu slash Sikh slash Jain friends. The Jains do Diwali as well, Festival of Lights stuff. It's a cool thing, all right? Anything else going on? Current events right this second? Okay, all right, see, hey, why I went backwards here? What the hell happened? Seems like if you tuned in last week to our online lecture, we were talking about Russia. Does this sound right to everybody? Am I in the right time zone? Am I sober? All right, so we're talking about Russia. Certainly one of the premier world powers. I don't know that I would call it a superpower anymore, but certainly a top-tier world power, worthy of our attention for a lecture or two. Because they are back, baby. They are making more and more of a difference as every day passes. And if you didn't write this down last week in your notes, write it down now. Russia is resurgent. Remember how after 3 lectures of China, I said, don't think about China as rising to power. Think about China as returning to power. And you could apply that definition to Russia a lot as well. Russia is resurgent right now. They're coming back. They crashed and burned, much like China did for the last couple hundred years. But Russia crashed and burned just for the last couple decades. And now they're resurging back. Every week and every month and every year that passes, Russia gets a little more powerful, mostly in its neighborhood. In its direct vicinity, but it is a global power player of note. It often serves as the foil that spoils U.S. plans and a lot of things that are going on in Europe, in Central Asia, and indeed over in the Far East in China and Japan. Okay, so we should look into this a little bit further, and I believe we only got as far as the physical world last Wednesday, and I was saying that in the broad scope of history, this biggest state in the world that we call Russia is actually not that old. Now, you look back and say, oh, 1300, wow, that's ancient. Yeah, it's 700 years, but it's really not that big a deal in the greater scheme of things. It's not like a China, all right? It's not like it's been around for thousands of years because it kind of started as a small commune around what's now present-day Moscow 700 years ago. And even by 1462, when they threw off the yoke of the Mongol Empire, which was centered over here, I don't know, in Mongolia. the Mongol Empire, which swept across Asia and kicked the living hell out of everybody, including the Ruskies, and controlled this whole area. It wasn't until 1462 that the Russians threw off that yoke, fought back under this guy named Ivan the Great and then his son Ivan the Terrible, and thus started the meteoric rise of this modern state that we call Russia. So back in 1462, they were just getting on their feet, just starting to fight back against the Mongols, and the Mongols were kind of crashing and burning anyway, for those interested in history. And they were then going to start expanding and consolidating their empire. So by the year 1500, just 500 years ago, and again, think about that, just 500 years ago, Russia was still not a major player in anything. 500 years ago is when the Europeans were coming in their heyday, and Columbus sailed, and America's getting discovered. Russia's just starting up still at this point. They consolidated lands to the north and started pushing against the remnants of the Mongol Empire over here, so it started pushing eastward in an effort to kick the Mongols when they were down and expand their territory. But again, 500 years ago, still not a major player. No one in Europe's thinking that much about Russia or anyone in the world. By 100 years later, now they progress a little further south down to the Caspian Sea. But here's where they start getting serious. Now they're a formidable force. Now they're a civilization on the rise. Now they're getting some national pride and some power and establishing bigger armies under good generals who start kicking the living crap out of everybody. And in 200 years, sweep across Asia. Eastward ho. And really form the largest land empire current to date. Gigantic. This is what I told you last week. It's two Canadas. You can fit two Canadas inside of this. And Canada's the second biggest country on planet Earth. So Russia really is just ginormous. I would actually suggest it's probably too big. I don't know that Russia will survive another 100 years. It's almost too big to manage. But for now, biggest state on planet Earth. Yes, sir. Absolutely. He makes a good point. Most of this area that we refer to from like here all the way over to here is called what? Siberia. And who's there? Some natives and a shit ton of walruses, I guess, because nobody else wants to hang out in this place. So yes, the sweep across the continent was not terribly difficult, but don't underestimate the locals. And don't underestimate that Russia actually is what we call a multicultural society. Go ahead and jot that down. Much like America, Russia is a multicultural society. When we think of Russia, we're like, oh, it's all Russians there. No. As I pointed out, Russians, this group of people that we ethnically identify as Russians, started way over here in the Moscow area. When they start sweeping across Asia, they're taking over Asian populations, indigenous peoples, Kazakhs and Mongols, and eventually Chinese. So there's a lot of different folks, nicely played, there's a lot of different folks in this big land area in terms of variety. And yes, many of these, there were still some of the Golden Horde left, some of the Mongols, where they were still fighting all the way across, okay? So there was local resistance along the way, but with overwhelming force, it wasn't that hard to take these places over, and it was mostly a negotiation in a lot of places. The locals would trot out, the Ruskies would bring a big army up and say, "We are Russia, and we will take over this area," and people said, "Yeah, sure. It's like me and this dude and a walrus. Whatever, all right? Put a flag down. Nobody gives a crap." So that was the case in some parts of their Asian sweep, but not all. Not all for sure. And there were some pitched battles. What I do want you to note is that we often overlook this. Isn't this a lot like America's evolution? It kind of is, but in different directions, and roughly at the same time. Isn't that cool? So, you know, give or take 100 years. The Ruskies start over here, all right, throw off their yoke of imperialism by the Mongols, and start to expand across the continent, absorbing a shit ton of territory and local indigenous populations. That's exactly what happened in America. We on the East Coast overthrew European imperialist pigs, got our shit together, built an army, started expanding westward across the continent. Isn't that interesting? In almost the same ways, in virtually the same time period. But we don't ever think about that when we think about our Russian brothers and sisters, do we? Okay? And built what would become a couple hundred years later the two superpowers that were fighting it out for planetary domination during the Cold War. It's just a strange coincidence. Our societies evolved in virtually the same way. But jot this down, because you don't see this in textbooks anywhere. What do we think of when we think of the people that went west to take over the American continent? How would you describe those people? Explorers? Any others? Terms? Pioneers? The frontiersmen? Cowboys, maybe? Gold rushers? All of those exact terms and the culture that you associate with cowboys, frontiersmen, explorers. Russia had that exact same shit. Exactly. So there are cowboys out on the Siberian steppes. And there were fur trappers and traders and explorers. The same story that you know for America applies to Russia, but again, in the opposite direction across the Asian continent. Indeed, think about this. As this continues, in 1855, Russia, of course, and for those of you who know your American history, you know this test question. Russia crosses over the Bering Strait and takes Alaska. Did you know that? You probably got that shit in third grade. They were still expanding. What you probably didn't get in third or fourth grade is they were expanding all the way down the west coast of America. There was Russian flags planted outside of San Francisco at one point. There are still two or three Russian kind of fortresses on some of the Hawaiian islands. Did you know that too? They were a people on the move, an expanding empire. Again, very much like America at the time. And think about it. We were sweeping across the continent to eventually take over California. The Ruskies were coming from the other direction to take Alaska and come down the west coast of the American, okay, all right, the American, North American continent, all the way down to San Fran. The two empires met 200 years ago. Well, 150 years ago. Isn't that cool? Maybe it's not cool to you. It's cool to me. But whatever happened to Alaska, by the way? They sold it to us. What a dumbass move that was. Wouldn't that have changed the Cold War if the Ruskies had held on to Alaska and could have put a hell ton of missiles up there? Slightly different. Sorry, Russia, you lose. Thanks for the purchase of Alaska, which also has a shit ton of oil. Now, so that's 1855. By 1945, we have what's now the Soviet Union. And we're going to talk about this history in a little bit of detail. But consider that they pushed southward at this point, and the Soviet Union, aka the Ruskies, controlled all of what is now Central Asia. And we're still continuing to push even further southward, putting pressure on Iran, trying to have maybe an outlet to the Indian Ocean by taking more territory down there. And now we get into kind of more modern history where the Russian Empire is bumping into the British Empire and bumping into the Chinese and bumping into the Europeans over here because they're that big and they've become that powerful. Now they're a major player that's in the European history books in the last 100 years. So southward push to control what's now all of the Central Asian region, all these five or six Central Asian stand states. Okay. However, it didn't end there. You also know that we're in the Cold War period by 1945, and by 1955, the Ruskies, I have it lit up in pink over here, they don't own Eastern Europe, but they pretty much control Eastern Europe. They don't own it, but they pretty much control it. So they have expanded westward as well. At the height of the Soviet Empire, and it's about right here, they crossed over 13 different time zones. 13 different time zones in a single continuous mass, which they either outright controlled or pretty much controlled, because Poland and Czechoslovakia, those are all puppet states. Okay? They crossed over half the Earth's surface, this one mighty, mighty empire. But to get it into modern era, they then imploded. They lost the Cold War. They sucked. Communists were losers. They went away. And it retracted down to still the biggest country on planet Earth, but not quite as big as it used to be. In fact, easy test question for you to know. You probably know it already after reading the chapter. How many countries were created when the Soviet Union imploded? Great call. 15 is the answer. 15 new sovereign states were created when the USSR imploded and went away. That includes the state of Russia, by the way. Okay? So Russia, over this grand sweep of five to 600 years, went from a tiny dink nothing to taking over the entire 13 time zones of territory and retracted back. I think they still cover 10 or 11 time zones. This is a big place. Big place full of resources and all the other stuff that we talked about. However, what is life like during this time frame? This is an important thing to consider. We're trying to understand the Russian psyche, and I'm going to apologize right up front if I'm going to piss off any of my Russian friends in here, because this is not going to be nice or kind or friendly or warming, or we ain't singing Kumbaya or having, you know, pillow fights in Russia. This is a hard place to live. It's a cold place. The climate is extremely challenging. Hard winters occur often. Starvation occurs often. Bad crop years occur often. That's just life, okay? That's how it is life in Russia. Then on top of that, for hundreds of years, they have a system which, for us in the modern world, we would have considered something akin to slavery. And I'm talking to all the people of Russia, not one or two of them. I'm talking something we would call serfdom, the feudal system, for those of you that know your European and British history. And here's what that entails. The people, humans, in Russia, for virtually all of its history, don't really have human rights or individual rights like we consider them. Humans, for most of Russian history, would be something closer to property. Now, not an outright slave, but they were tied to the land. Again, you think of feudal Europe. Knights of the Round Table and bullshit, and people doing jousting crap, all right? And the landowner, the duke or lord, owns this land. And he doesn't necessarily own the people on that land, but let's face it, they work for him. So if I was the duke, and this was my lands, this class was my lands, you, who are living on my lands and plowing my lands and growing food on my lands, you pretty much, you work for me. I can come in at any time and take all of your stuff. You'll have to give me like half the food you raise or more. That's how the feudal system works. In exchange, I'll protect you from the next duke or knight over who may come and try to kill us at some point. Okay? That's how it works. Also, and by the way, this is how it worked in Russia. So the aristocracy, the land-holding aristocracy, pretty much controlled humans, and they were tied almost in a slave-like situation to the place they live. In this particular Russian style of doing things, this also meant that me, the aristocratic dude who owns this land, I am the judge and jury also. So any crimes that are committed on my land, I deal with that. You steal something from somebody else, well, I have the power just to kill you. That's the way it worked. Full-on peasant style for most of Russian history. And then again, let me revisit, it's cold as hell, starvation is frequent. Yes? Why did no one successfully invade Russia? You're saying, oh, the climate is part of the reason why no one has successfully invaded Russia. That is true. Many have tried to take over Russia, and many have come and got their asses frostbit and left. It is one of the things that saves Russia a lot of the time, as people say, oh, too big an area to take over, too cold an area to maintain. But back to the peasant lifestyle, serfdom happened across Europe. It happened in other parts of the world. Slavery happened in other parts of the world. So why am I bringing this up about Russia? Because in Russia, everything I just told you about happened for a very long time, most of its history, and it persisted late into the game. It persisted. So cold, bitter, hard life. Most folks are serfs. It's a feudal system for centuries. And it wasn't until the peasant emancipation of 1861, that's an interesting date. That's when we got rid of slavery in our country. And that was when they decided to have a proclamation in Russia to say, you know, people really shouldn't be treated like a piece of shit. Maybe humans should have rights here too. Maybe they should be able to own land. I don't know. It's crazy. Maybe the landowner shouldn't be allowed to kill them whenever he feels like it. Crazy talk, I know. But let's have this Emancipation Act of 1861. You can jot it down if you like. That's nice. You can jot down the time, the date, the Emancipation Act of 1861 in Russia. That's when it was passed. It was pretty much largely ignored long after that. So again, the reason I'm telling you this story is 1861, that's not that long ago. You didn't have feudal societies in Great Britain in 1861. They had already gotten over it. They were already starting to have some sort of representative democracies and have human rights and stuff. They were modernizing in Europe and industrializing. 1861, hell, the United States was on the brink of industrialization. And we were banning slavery. Russia, eh. Change came slow. Change came late. That's what I want you to remember. So 1861 is way late to be talking about not having a feudal system in a major world power. And on top of that, political power was concentrated in an old school style monarchy. The Romanovs, a single family line, okay, single family line, ruled from 1613 to 1917. They still had a king on the throne of Russia who had all power in 1917? That's really late. Really late. Hell, China had already gotten rid of their emperor at that point. The idea of a king having royal power over the entire domain, that was laughable in Europe by 1917. Hell, we had a revolution in our country 150 years earlier to throw those assholes out. So most of the world had already moved on to some sort of human rights situation. A democracy situation, even if it was representative or a constitutional monarchy situation. Russia is very late to this game. And the other thing on top of that is, in this feudal system, in this concentrated political power of monarchy, this is a stagnant-ass society. As you might imagine, if people are living the same way and ruling the same way in this country since they were 600 years earlier, how advanced could they be? How advanced could they be? Do you think that their economy was vibrant? Do you think that they were technologically up to snuff, hanging out with the Europeans? Do you think their army was as good as European or American armies? Hell no. So you put all this together and you have a place that is quite a bit behind the times economically, politically, industrially, economically. Russia is a late bloomer. Now we're getting into the modern era. They're just behind. And by the way, they know it. Right? But they're still this gigantic superpower that no one really gives a shit about. They're not important economically or politically in Europe or the world. And then it really starts to get worse. Because that's just the way that it was. Now let's get to some titanic 20th century events, which are going to start to rub some serious salt into a festering wound that is Russia. Damn, that sounded poetic. I just made that shit up, all right? So what events am I going to talk about? I'm not going to talk about every single damn thing that happened in Russia for the last 100 years, okay? I just summarized their first 600 years in less than 20 minutes. So we'll try to keep this tight, but I want you to understand Russia today. So you kind of got to know what they've been through in the last 100 to see why, even now, 2012, that we don't have the best relationship with this country. And I understand, as much as I made fun of him, I understand why people like presidential aspirant Mitt Romney were willing to say that he thought Russia was the number one enemy of the United States. And many of us were like, what are you smoking, dude? What? Russia? But once you understand the bigger scope of what Russia's been through and the relationship between them and us in the last 100 years, I can kind of get it. So let's get to this relationship. What is up with Russia? How is it they crashed and burned and got bigger and better and crashed and burned again? Because, I'll say it again for those that missed it the first time, the story of Russia in the last 100 years is very similar to the story of China in the last 300 years. Does everybody remember the China lecture? I said China was awesome, and then they waned and waxed, and then they started crashing and burning, and they sucked, and they went through civil war, and then they rose back up again, and now they're back up. That's kind of Russia, but in a condensed time period. Russia's going to get really big and great. They're going to crash and burn. They're going to get really great again in a much smaller time period. Give it like 50 years. Okay? So that's the arc. I want to tell the tale to you now, and here's where it starts with the Titanic 20th century events. How does it start? The ones I want to point out. Well, I've now set the stage. This is a place that's a little behind, to say the least. It's a big-ass country. It's an important political power. But nobody in Europe or the rest of the world trades with them that much. They're technologically stagnant. They're not that big a deal. But it's a big empire, all right, with a proud tradition. And so in 1904, 1905, when Japan declares war on Russia, this is a big deal. Japan, that little group of islands off our coast, we're the most gigantic empire in the world. Some little group of islands declared war on us. We will crush them. That's not the way it worked out. It's part of the start of the downfall of Russia. All right, why the hell would Japan have declared war on Russia to begin with? Seems like biting off a little more than you can chew. Well, if you remember our China lecture, you realize that China was crashing and burning in the late 1800s into the 1900s, okay? And all the countries around, the Europeans, but also the Russians, were intervening and trying to influence and take over more and more area of China while China was weak. Russia was in on that game. They were extending their influence and took over parts of these areas up here, okay? And they did control this one, the only kind of real major port on their west coast, I'm sorry, their east coast, called Vladivostok. But Russia, it never has really had good ports. And Vladivostok's not a good port either. It's too far away. It's not deep enough. It's not good for a huge Navy military base. So they were always looking to expand. We want to expand our imprint, our thumbprint. We want to expand our influence and our territory. Look, China's really weak and they suck. Let's push down here further. And indeed, that's what the Russians did and start to took over part of what we call Manchuria in modern-day China, and pushed down and took over this little peninsula where there was this really good port called Port Arthur. I don't expect you to know all these details. I do want you to understand that Russia was intervening and encroaching on Chinese territory at this time of Chinese weakness. Got it? So write that part down if you didn't write any of it, the rest of it down. But you also know, if you watched that awesome Japan lecture, which most of you did, that Japan was rising to power at this same time and saw that China was sucking and decided to copy and mimic the West, have a Meiji restoration, build a mighty empire, imperial army themselves. And so Japan was on the move. And they were pushing and had already taken over the Korean Peninsula. You know this. 1895, the Sino-Japanese War. How many people, show of hands, remember what the hell I'm talking about right there? There you go. I love you people. Damn, I'm giving somebody some damn points. So 1895, Japan is pushing up this direction and taking over with ambitions to take over more. At the same time, Russia's coming in from the north and trying to take over more so they can get a good port down here. And the two powers, of course, inevitably clash. Side note to you awesome people sitting here in lecture who are really into this stuff and want to know the world. I've never even talked about this in any former class ever. I never really thought it was important. I only talk about history when I think it's important for today. And I'm telling you, 2 years ago, I didn't think this story was important. I do now. Why do you think I think this story is important now? I don't expect you to know the answer. I'm not sure that I even know the answer. What's happening in the world? What's happening in this part of the world? There's more and more attention being paid here, isn't there? There's more and more potential conflict points happening on small islands between China and Japan. The United States is sending military people to Australia. The Pacific Rim is happening again. And these old stories that we call history play into the modern era. They affect events right now. And so here's why I think the story is important now. Everybody thinks that Russia and China were best buddies during the Cold War. How many people already thought that? Yeah, Russia was communist. China was communist. They're all big commie buddies. They had a communist party. Get it? Party, communist party. Never mind, all right? So a lot of Americans think, oh, yeah, the Russians and the Chinese, they were all commies. They're all in bed together. Those are the bad guys. They're going to take over the world. These two countries have never really liked each other. There you go. There it is. When China was weak, Russia was kicking down its northern door coming in. China has not forgot that. China has a friendlier relationship with Russia, but they're not best buddies. Not by a long shot, not today. But it's warming up. Japan has conflict with China over some islands in this area. And here's the kicker that I do want you to write down. Japan and Russia also have conflict over a small group of islands up there as well. An open conflict that is still unresolved. You're going to see that one get hot again soon too. So that's what was turning in my brain to think about, why is it that these three main powers, Japan, Russia, and China, would be dinking around about groups of islands in this part of the world in 2012 right now today? Ah, because you got to know your history to know what's going on here. These guys were contending for power and territory 100 years ago, and they still are. That's what I'm talking about, okay? So how did this end for Russia? So Japan's coming out this way. Russia's coming down. They want a better ports. They want to take over part of China as well, but Japan wants to thwart that, and so they have a little war. Land war actually occurred in Manchuria. It was a bloodbath by all accounts. Tens of thousands of dead. You think of over 100 years ago, good old-fashioned, old-school warfare with rifles and bayonets, people getting bayoneted to death and shit. It was Japan's first land battle. It was against Russia, this gigantic country, right? And Japan, for the most part, slaughtered the Ruskies. But everybody was like, you know what, that's not that big a deal. We're still talking about small armies, and Russia is a gigantic country with a gigantic army and a gigantic navy. Ah, the navy is what we want, okay? This is just showing some old pictures of Japanese people killing Russian people. That always excites you, I'm sure. So everybody, when this war happened, Russians were like, WTF, you've got to be kidding me. The Japanese have declared war on us, and they're killing Russian soldiers out there in the Far East. Send the Navy. Let's destroy these punks. Because the Russian Navy is strong, and it's big, and we're powerful. Unfortunately, as I've now suggested, they don't have a lot of ports over on the East Coast. So they had to send their entire fleet. Remember where they're at. They have to send their entire fleet from the Black Sea and the Baltic Sea, where all their ships are. So when this happens, and this slaughter starts to occur, the Russians were so fired up, they're like, send the whole damn fleet. Let's punish this group of uppity Japanese folks and put an end to this war real quick. They sent virtually all their battleships, their modern-day destroyers, everything they had from these areas. They had to go all the way around the Cape, around Africa, through the Indian Ocean, through Southeast Asia, got all the way up here, sent the mighty Russian Navy formed up. Mustered up, the ships come in. Does anybody know the end of this story? They get the living shit kicked out of them in 15 minutes. absolutely and utterly destroyed. This is a battle that's like goes down in the hallmark of warfare as the most one-sided, worst naval battle of all time. The Japanese ships are all just sitting there in a row saying, hey, look, they're coming.
Cool.
Hi, we Japanese, we're ready to play. Come on in. We got some Pokemon for your ass, all right? And the Russian ships just come in and boom, boom, all day long. Most of it was over within an hour. All the ships are on the bottom of the sea, gone. Whole Russian fleet, gone. And Russia's like, what just happened? By the way, side note, most of the rest of the world was like, holy crap, what happened there? Maybe that's a test question. This Russo-Japanese war was a wake-up call for the world that, hey, Japan is some serious shit. Japan just beat Russia. What? What? That's crazy talk. That's impossible. Yeah. The Japanese had already beat up some Chinese folks. Who gives a shit about that? But when they beat the Russians, a semi-European power, oh man, they're in the big leagues now. And of course, Japan's going to stay in the big leagues right on up to the end of World War II. Most one-sided naval battle perhaps in history. Absolute and utter destruction. I don't know, 10, 20, 30,000 soldiers all dead. All the ships at the bottom of the sea are captured. It's just over. It's just messy. Terrible messy. And the reason I'm telling you this story is this has a huge impact on the Russian psyche. Because here they are, this gigantic, awesome, supposedly superpower that just got their ass handed to them by the Japanese islands that nobody had heard of 100 years earlier. So they're already stagnant. They're industrially, technologically behind. They know it. And now they just got beat by an unknown power. This weighs heavy on the mind. It weighs heavy on the mind because the leadership kind of sensed that they might be in trouble at this point. One of the things that even dictators usually do well is protect their country, right? A king's a good king, or a dictator's even a decent dictator, even if he sucks to his own people, as long as he can protect his people from foreigners. And the Russians now can't even do that. And now I've already told you, life for the average Russian sucks already. So now you have the peasants who are like, what's the point of all of this? We suck, our lives suck, and our government can't even beat Japan. And this does lend itself, doesn't start it, but something called the Russian Revolution, put that kind of in quotes because it's not the Russian Revolution you're thinking of, okay? There's a big Russian Revolution in 1917, the Communist Revolution, we'll get to that in a second. But in 1905, as all of this mess with the Japanese war is occurring, there's people at home who are already agitating to change the system. And there had been since 1861. There are people saying, our country sucks. You must be kidding me. Look, we can see Europe from here. We can travel there. We can trade. We know how shitty we are. We need to change our system. We need to industrialize, mechanize, do something. Change our political structure. Give us some damn rights. Come on, you gotta be joking me. We're getting so far behind. So people started agitating, started to take to the streets. There were general strikes across the country. People came out and actually almost in a good mood saying, we're going to change our country. We're going to have a kind of a revolution. And the government, because they were sucking in this war, were more pliable. So they're like, okay, everybody chill. Don't strike. Don't get uppity. We'll create some sort of parliament. We'll call it the Duma. And we'll give you guys some voice in it. And the people pushed for more. And they actually were surrounding the Winter Palace at one point saying, we want more rights, we want to change our system, we want to go to some sort of parliamentary democracy or constitutional monarchy like those Europeans. And at one point, at the end of late in 1905, the government had had enough. The monarchy had had enough, and they just sent out the troops to slaughter all the protesters, which they did, depicted here, just slaughter people in the streets, okay, on Bloody Sunday. It seems like a lot of countries have something called a Bloody Sunday. And Russia, indeed, did have a Bloody Sunday as well. This was it. So even though people were agitating for change, the government continued to repress it. Even at one point, they thought about having some change and created this Duma. They then changed their mind a week later and said, never mind, never mind. We don't, game off. No, we're just going to kill everybody. Okay? So further suppression, building up this pressure cooker that is the Russian people. And for those of you that know any history at all, you kind of know where this story is going to start going from here. Because as this crappy situation continues to be perpetrated through the 1905 protest strikes and massacre, you have this dude in charge, Tsar Nicholas, okay? Tsar Nicholas II, the last of the Romanovs. He's pretty much an idiot. He is the one who's overseen this disastrous war with Japan. He is the one who's repressed his people. He's just, the last in a long line of kings who repressed his people. But he's now in the hot seat because his country is going down the shitter and fast. And people know it. So he has this brilliant idea. Actually, one of his ambassadors had this brilliant idea. Here's how you can restore honor to the throne and rally the Russian people. Here's what we can do to get everybody right behind the monarchy again. Let's get into World War I. Yes! We already lost the war to a small group of islands. Let's start a major war with Germany. And everybody knows Germans kick ass, all right? They didn't know who the Japanese were. Everybody knows the Germans. You're not getting into a fight with them and walking away without at least a serious limp. So World War I had started in Europe. Russia was not involved initially, was not involved. Yes, they had some alliances. They were supposed to help some people out. But they were not actively involved. And then his advisor, one of his most trusted advisors, said, you should really get into World War I. Boy, it'll do wonders for your image. Does anybody know what dumbass advisor told the Tsar to get in this war? Yeah, this awesome guy called Rasputin. He wasn't even a government worker. He was a monk. He was a crazy ass, probably shooting heroin into his eyeballs, supposed monk who went around healing drunk socialite women, all right? And by healing, I mean having sex with them. So apparently he was like one of the most nasty humans ever. He was like 7 foot tall. He looked like Lurch, greasy, long black hair and a black beard, never shaved. People thought he had magical powers, and he had the ear of the queen. The queen thought he truly was like a reincarnation of Jesus or something. You know why I tell you these stories, by the way? To show you how completely and utterly screwed up this place was. That this idiot was the one making the calls of what the Russian government was going to do. And he told that idiot, yeah, you should go to war with Germany. That's a great idea. Go do that while I have sex with all the socialites here in the royal court. That's fantastic. So they went out on a white horse to the battle lines of World War I, and does anybody know what happened next? They got the shit kicked out of them in World War I as well, and even worse than the Japanese had done, because now you're talking about tens of thousands, perhaps millions of casualties on the war front, and now they're losing territory. They lost big sections of territory. And I kept saying the Germans. It's more the Austro-Hungarian Empire and the Germanic Empire and who the hell ever else was involved in World War I. These guys just ate the Russians for lunch and were pushing them back. And now Russia is losing part of its kind of real deal territory. They're just losing. This is a shambles. The government is a shambles. The military is a shambles. Their economy is a shambles. And thus, now we know what's going to happen next. Oh, let me point this out. Here's why World War I is important to the Ruskies. Please note this. I'm getting a little ahead of the story, but they were losing so bad. You see this light purple strip here in the middle? Not the dark purple, not the light. This middle purple. That's sections of Poland, Latvia, Lithuania, Estonia, Moldova, which is now part of Ukraine. See that strip? This is the strip that they just gave up just to get the hell out of World War I. They just said, here, take it, we're out. Okay? Keep that in mind. Keep that in mind because it affects the events of the rest of the 20th century. They lost part of Russia proper. Got it? Okay. And here's why it's important. Russia bailed out of World War I. They were losing so bad, like I said, they said, here, just take the property we've already lost. We don't give a shit. We want out. We surrender or whatever. Draw the lines. You guys go fight somewhere else. They gave that territory to the Austro-Hungarians / Germans. Unfortunately, the Germans also then later lost World War I. You with me? Everybody staying with me? So the Russians gave a bunch of shit to the Germans. The Germans then lost World War I as well. So a bunch of shit got taken from Germany, including all this territory. All right? And here's why it's important. The Russians gave them all this stuff. Then Germany lost, so they had to give it all back. And who did they give it back to? They gave it back to this whole set of countries that got created. So here's the German Empire, Austro-Hungarian Empire, Ukraine, Mother Russia. Here it is pre-World War I. Watch the slide carefully now. This is what it looked like before World War I started. By the end of it, it looked something more like this. And that's because those big empires had gotten destroyed. Okay? The Austro-Hungarian Empire just went away and a bunch of countries popped up in its place. The German Empire lost a bunch of its territory. It still had Germany. And Russia had lost a big section of this strip over here. But Russia had given it away to the Germans, who then had to give it away to whoever. And who got it was, hey, that's actually Eastern Europe. All right? Those countries are what we'd call Eastern European countries. These are countries that got independence. And maybe I have a slide here that shows it a little bit better. Yeah, I think I do. So Russia lost the territory. Germany then lost the territory. They all became independent states. And from that point forward, both Russia and Germany basically wanted their shit back. And we're talking in between World War I and World War II. The Russians had lost. The Germans had lost. And both parties were like, we would like to reclaim that which we have lost. Right? But I've gotten a little bit ahead of my story. Let's go back to the story now. This war was so freaking disastrous for Russia, but also personally for Tsar Nicholas, that it did help spawn the now what we're going to call 1917 Russian Revolution, a.k.a. Bolshevik Revolution, Soviet Revolution, Communist Revolution. Call it whatever you want. For you hardcore historians, I know the Bolshevik Revolution is actually a slightly different thing. I'm going to treat it all as the same. It was a revolution that started the General Revolution. You can just write down 1917, Communist Revolution. This is when Russia went commie. Why did it happen? Because of all of the shitstorm of stuff I've now described that's been occurring to Russia. And now everybody is thoroughly pissed off with the state of affairs, with their own country, and certainly with their leadership. Much like we talked about over in China. People were just like, what the hell? Our whole country sucks. We at least need to get rid of the rulers. They're the ones that led us down this shit path. So they got to get chucked out. And thus, you had the rise of the Bolsheviks, a.k.a. the communists, who come in under this guy, Vladimir Lenin. Not Vladimir Putin, we'll get to him later. But the main commie man, Vladimir Lenin, who had since early 1900 been agitating for change and saying our system sucks. And he was one of the people who, during the 1905 uprisings, was like, yes, let's destroy the whole government. Overthrow all these assholes. Let's build a new system. He was first put in jail in Siberia, then later deported and lived in Switzerland for most of this era up to this point. But he was the one agitating from afar and reading things like Marx and Engels and communist ideology. And he said, ha, that's what we need to do with Russia. That's what we need to do. Have a communist revolution. And indeed, as the events of World War I were unfolding, as Russia was disintegrating, as it became evident to everybody that our king is listening to some crazy mad monk, that's who's giving orders here? It's now time for a change, and now everybody's kind of on board. And Lenin realizes this from afar, and rallies support and rallies people and takes the train back into Moscow to start the communist revolution. I'm not going to get into the nuts and bolts of it. Needless to say, you know the end of it. They won, all right? Through political maneuvering, they take over the Duma, they take over the government, and turn Russia into the USSR. Union of Soviet Socialist Republics. Okay, that's the 1917. This is one of the major revolutions of the 20th century. Full-on true revolution. Not like, oh, we have a new president, or oh, we threw out the other president or killed him and we have somebody who took his place. No, no, no. That's a change of power. This is a revolution. A revolution is when you introduce completely and utterly new ideas, completely and utterly new styles of governance. And if you didn't know this, write it down now. These guys are the first ones to experiment with any of this stuff. This experiment, 1917, they're the first ones that tried to implement communism in a country. It's all new ground. Engels and Marx and all these other commie writers had been writing about it, but none of those dudes did anything. Russia was the first one to try. Okay? They wanted to try it. What did they want to try? They wanted full-on equality, taken to the extreme, is what most of us would say at this point in history, with hindsight of history. And that is, yes, they wanted to have political equality. Everybody has human rights. Everybody has liberal human rights. Everybody can vote. Women and men are equal. I mean, communism, for all of its faults, most of us would agree with most of the principles. Yeah, everybody's equal. Men and women are equal. Everybody should have rights. You should be protected by the rule of law. I mean, it has all that stuff there. But then they take it several steps that most of us don't agree with, which is all and everybody should be economically equal. And we, the government, will oversee that everybody is economically equal. There will be no more aristocracy. There will be no more landed aristocratic class that owns stuff or has privilege. There's not going to be rich people in country clubs. There won't be poor people either. We're going to make it all equal for everybody. How does that work out, by the way? It fails every freaking time. But these are the first guys to try it. Okay? And they were going to implement something, and they tried, called the command economy. Go ahead and jot that down. The command economy. So it was a political system that was also an economic system. And I'm sure I'm repeating myself because you've read this in the textbook already. But it bears repeating. It's a political system that's very much like democracy, but also an economic system where we're going to make everybody equal. We're going to command the economy. Everybody will do what we tell them to. We will decide where the farms are at. We'll decide where the factories are. We'll decide who works where. We'll decide where the doctor's offices are. We'll decide who becomes a doctor. And everybody will just give each other all the stuff they need. So you go to the doctor for free. The farmer gives you food for free. You work at the factory for free, but then you get a car at the fact that you made at the factory for free. Everybody gets everything they need. Yay, happy time, dreamland, all right? That's communism. And that's what they tried to implement. Oh, by the way, I just remembered, I did not make an announcement. We're having a fire drill tonight. So at exactly 9 o'clock, will alarm sound? So alarms will sound. Please don't panic. This is a fire drill. But I've been asked to actually pretend like it is a real fire. So pretend like you actually see a fire in the middle of the room, which means, hold on. I don't mean run over top of people and climb over the chairs, because that's what we would really do. Pretend there's a fire right in the middle of the room, and so go to the nearest immediate exit. For all you people in the front, go to the sides. In other words, really try to get the living hell out of the building as quickly as possible. Is that cool with everybody? Can you do that for me at 9 o'clock? Yes. How's the extra credit for tonight working? You all got it. Is that okay with everybody? You just get it. Oh, I tell you what, here's the deal. How many extra credit points is that going to give you? 175? I really said that? You can cheer all you damn want. You're not getting 175 points. But I think did I say 20 points for coming to class? 25. This is not an auction, all right? Do I hear 30? 30, 35, 35, 40! No, it's not an auction. I tell you this, though, okay? I'll give you the heads up, because we want to make sure that World Regions has the best fire drill ever, all right? We want to be number one at fire drills. So, at 5 minutes till, if you could start packing up your stuff, at 5 minutes till, we still have 17 minutes of class, okay? Just before 9, start packing up. And if everybody can exit the building within, what's the time frame we're looking at? 3 minutes. If everybody can get the hell out of this building in 3 minutes, I'll give you another 5 points. How about that? All right? So be sure you go to the appropriate exits, all right? I'm sorry, you have a question, sir? Oh, you don't need a Scantron. You're just going to get it. I got you covered. All right, let's get back to commies, though. We don't want to go into Thanksgiving break until we know more about commies. Yeah. Can you come back for? Yes, the invisible children people will also leave the building, but then they'll be allowed back in after everybody gets out of the building. Yeah, they're gonna keep shop there. Okay. No, no, you can't leave yet, or the deal's off. All right, if everybody leaves now and doesn't do the fire drill, the deal is off. We'll deal with the points in just a minute. Let's get another 15 minutes of knowledge going, though. You've stayed this long, which means you're the good students, so let's press on. Let's press on. The commie revolution did not happen quietly, by the way. Okay, it was kind of a palace coup. They did politically take over. Here's what I want you to know. It's definitely a test question. Definitely a test question. Do you think every single person in Russia wanted to be a communist in 1917? No. Most people in Russia, and this would be something like a crazy true and false question, in 1917, most people in Russia had no idea what the hell a communist was. They were in a shitty state that was falling apart economically, militarily, and at the end of World War I. They could care less about communism, but they wanted change. That makes sense? Okay, they want to change. And this is also a test question for those of you toughing it out for the last 10 minutes. One of the reasons that Vladimir Lenin got into power was because of a campaign pledge he was making. To do what? Anybody know? Get it from the book? Not land reform, you're close. Oh no, they were saying we're going to communize all your asses. I mean, they were saying all that. All gonna be equal, land reform, equality, blah, blah, blah. That was part of it. That's not what got him into office so quickly. Here's the answer on the test. Vladimir Lenin very smartly walked back into Russia in 1917 and said, if you support my cause, I will get us the hell out of World War I. You support my cause, and we're out, because we're losing, and this is a bloodbath, and what in the hell are we doing in this war anyway? Our stupid-ass leadership has drug us into an international conflict which does not benefit us, and we are dying for nothing. And that was something that Russians were like, yeah, I got that. Communism, I don't know. Get us out of World War I, I understand. Think about how history repeats itself. Do candidates in today's world say, I'll get us out of Iraq. I'll get us out of Afghanistan. It's a powerful draw to get support. So that was one of the things that Lenin promised. And also note this, if you haven't put two and two together here, he's the one who did it. So I got ahead of my story and I said that the Russians lost all this territory. They lost that territory when Vladimir Lenin and his funky commie crew got in charge. And as soon as they got in charge, on day one, they went to the Germans and Austro-Hungarians and said, we're out. Write the damn document. Take the territory. We don't give a shit. We're out of this war. Now we're out. Again, side note to self, what they were saying in their heads was, we're not really giving up this territory. We'll be back. We'll be back, like Arnold Schwarzenegger. I'll be back to get Eastern Europe, all right? Hey, and he was from Eastern Europe. The commies had every intention on getting it back, but they wanted to put their house in order first. So they said, no, get out of the war, put our house in order, then we'll go back and get our shit. Make sense? made sense to Lenin and his crew, and it made sense to a lot of Russians as well. So that was one of the reasons they got into power. And as we now pointed out, you see the map behind it there, that they gave up that territory, they consolidated communist control over the government, and started to enact these changes to make it into a command economy and a communist political system. The next thing I want you to know, though, is, as suggested, not everybody was on board for this program. As you might imagine, feels like another test question because you're sticking it out. What group of people were not really into communism in Russia? The whites? Okay, well, most Russians are whites, all right? Actually, I know what you're talking about. He's not being unracist. There was actually a group of Russians called the whites. The white Russians is what they named themselves. Oh, like the drink. And it's almost time for one of those, all right? No, that's not the answer I'm looking for. What group of people in Russia in 1917 said, I don't want communism? The rich people. That's true in every communist revolution everywhere. The rich people don't want a communist revolution. Why the hell would they give up their stuff? They don't want equality. They've got the shit. So the aristocracy, the gentry, usually the people in charge of the military, because that's how it usually works, they said, no, we're not digging this at all. We're going to fight against this. So what you then had is the commies, which are the reds. I don't know why red is the color of communism. It just is. And that's why you'll hear communist haters say better dead than red, all right? So red is the color of communism. And so the Red Army became the official Soviet army. And the White Army, the white Russians, were the loyalists, basically. They were the conservatives who said, no, hell no, we're going to fight this tooth and nail. So about half of the army kind of deserted and reformed up as the White Army, the White Russian Army. And so they had themselves a good old-fashioned civil war. Feels like yet another test question since people are leaving. When Lenin and his commie crew took over, they didn't want to seem like evil bastards. So they said, look, monarchy, czar guy, you're done. You sucked, you screwed up our country, but we're not going to kill you. We're going to put you out to pasture. So they took the whole royal family, all of the royal family, and stuck them up in one of their winter homes somewhere. Sounds fair enough? And put a guard around them, obviously. But here's another easy test question. When the Civil War broke out, when it became evident that, holy crap, this is going to be a protracted war between a serious army that's fighting the Red Army, what was the first thing that Lenin did? I heard it. Go kill the royal family. Kill them all. Kill them all. Why on earth would he do that? It was the crazy idiot czar and his crazy mad monk idiot friend and his crazy wife and a bunch of kids. Why would you kill all of them? Did someone say distill their spirits? I like that. Nice. Here's why he did it. So test question one, as soon as the war broke out, Lenin personally gave the order, go kill the royal family, all of them. Here's question two, why would you do that? Because Lenin basically was deciding the fate of Russia either way. Either way, had the White Army won, who would they put back on the throne? There's nobody left. They killed them all. They killed off the royal line. So Lenin was basically saying, we're going forward here one way or the other. The Red Army may lose, but you ain't returning us to a monarchy because we just killed all their asses. And thus came the famous mythology about Anastasia. Has everybody heard that name? Have you seen the Disney movie? Oh, I love it. Yeah. It's not Disney's DreamWorks. I'm sorry. Gosh, you guys know the details. You didn't know why Lenin killed the royal family, but you know that it was DreamWorks and not Disney. Thanks. Bad knowledge. Bad knowledge. Get with the good knowledge. So Anastasia is this wonderful little myth that, when the royal family knew they were getting ready to get executed, they were getting ready to make a run for it, and so they were stuffing the kids' clothes full of silverware and stuff they could sell. Jewels, I guess, and shit. I don't know. And the mythology is that they were in a room. They just were in a room of their palace, and 10 guys with guns just walked in with muskets and just unloaded on a family of 8. Unloaded. And so the mythology is that the kids had this stuff stuffed in their shirts and that the bullets were bouncing off of them. And personal eyewitness accounts actually said that, yeah, the little kids were running around the room like some sort of circus thing, and bullets were bouncing off of them and shit, and people were screaming and yelling and dying. And so from that story comes the mythology that, she was only wounded and somehow she got away. Or they took them out and she escaped. And so the last of the Romanoff line is still alive. And thus the Disney, sorry, DreamWorks production of this princess whose family sucked ass and destroyed their country, who's still alive, and maybe she'll come back to power again someday, and a prince will put a glass slipper on her shit. I don't know what the hell that myth is about, because it's bullshit. They all died of lead poisoning, lead from a hell ton of bullets. All of them dead, all right? And that was the end of the Romanoff line. But we only have 3 minutes left, so can I tell you one more funny story? That, even though it sounds like a pretty gruesome death, was nothing compared to how they took care of Rasputin. Rasputin actually was killed before the revolution even started. Enough of the aristocracy and smart people around the king were like, this guy's insane. This mad monk guy is crazy. Crazy as a shithouse rat. And he's given all this advice to these people who are listening to him. And so a plot was developed to kill him. Now this mythology is actually closer to the truth. To kill him, because he's a pretty big guy, and people were kind of scared of him. He's a scary looking dude. To kill him, they invited him to a party. And they gave him a full bottle of wine that had been poisoned with strychnine, I think. He killed the whole thing. They gave him another bottle of poison wine. He killed that as well. People were like, he won't die. What are we supposed to do? We can't. And people were like behind the scenes. Imagine this party. I wish I'd have been at this party. It's an awesome party. People were like, how do we kill this son of a bitch? You do it. All right, someone go hit him in the head. Now you do it. All right. Okay, we draw straws. They drew straws. Someone took a club up behind him because he was starting to get woozy. After drinking 2 bottles of poison wine, he was getting woozy sitting at the table. So they went up behind him and clubbed his ass with like a log and dropped him, but then he started crawling away. So they started kicking the shit out of him, and somebody knifed him with a saber. Then someone else knifed him with a dagger. And they're like, okay, finally. Whew, let's all sit down and have a drink. And he started crawling away again. So then they clubbed him again, drug his ass outside, shot him a few times. He wasn't moving at this point. Then they took him to the river, not the Volga, the other one, in the middle of winter, and threw his ass over a bridge into the water, except the river was frozen, so he had ice. So his corpse supposedly was sitting on top of the ice. They went down and broke open the ice to push his dead ass in. Several days or weeks later, his body was actually recovered on the banks, and it was determined through autopsy he had actually drowned. That shit is real, right? That actually happened. And with that, I think we're going to have to wait for the... Oh, wait, we got to wait for the actual alarm. Okay, I'll keep talking. I'll keep talking to the alarm sounds. How about that? You have to... Can we... Okay. I'll keep talking. He's going to take a picture of you. We're pretending we have class. I'll end on this since you're getting... Holy crap! There's a fire! Get the hell out of here! Have a great Thanksgiving! Get the hell out!